I think President Steele touched on it a little bit, but I just want to introduce the topics of the meeting today. We're going to be talking a little bit about crisis and crisis prevention for students. And I think it's so important for us. We know the issues that are going on with our children. And we recognize that as educators and in regard to these students coming to the classroom. And us sometimes as educators dealing with that within the classroom environment. The other piece of this is, again, the importance of culture, especially in regard to Oglala living and culture education here, not only for Oglala, but across the region, across the nation, again, the importance of that culture in regard to self-identity. And if our children don't know where they're coming from, and how can they do well overall, they're a bit lost out there. So that's so important for us. Sir?
I represent the Oglala Supervisors Education Committee, and the chairman, Mr. Clifford, is not here. I'd like to say something on behalf of the education.
He's here. He's here.
Is he here?
Yep.
Are you going to say anything? If you're not, I have something to say. It won't be good.
I'm a doctor. Good morning. I'm CJ Clifford. I'm an education chairperson for the Oglala Sioux Tribe. One of the things that I just got to remember and remind people of is our treaty and the treaty obligations the United States government has to Indian education in particular today. But also we have a long-standing battle with the United States government for many years. Many years beyond some of our own ages here today. But at this time, I would like to give a couple minutes to my chair, Steve Emery, to briefly talk on the treaty, on what's actually happening today. It's a reality. The United States government is focusing and working on getting out of Indian education. But I just want to give them a couple minutes, if you guys don't mind. Thank you.
I'm going to talk to you how you used to have a chance to be on the field. Choose Pablo. Walk a lot of things that tell about this now. Meet a couple. That's a good character. Reach out. I'll follow a little young to him out the hunt. Yes, now. Oglala oyate wake we chasha ma hima chala. Yes, ma chika lo ha, na cha e api. Wo pe taka ki kiksu ya bo. Mo hem article 7, na wek se lo. Article 7, wo pe, mo mo spe ki. E ta ha, wa kani cha ki iu ha. E wo mo spe ki I chu ki kta. Wo I kshampa lo. Dot com. L reorganization today. Dot you talk shopping. You talk shopping. You can master is Sanya to Kataka. When you happy, this me. Dot when you happy, this the one happy. As Dot Abby. You talk shopping. Wana, o kola ki te ki, o wa sha ki ki iuha I hapta e api as. Maska doske, wonspe o kola ki te ki iam kapi kta su uyan chmi. Cha le tana, wonspe tanka, article 7, ki tsu ya po. You know, everybody likes to talk about the treaty. I want to say today in front of you people, I ain't talking about no 51 treaty. I'm talking about the 1868 treaty, April 29, 1868, Article 7. That's the one where the United States say, oh, we're gonna give you schools. Oh, hey, by the way, for 20 years. Only thing is, the 20 years, the sunset then never passed. Instead, after that, we had the Act of February 28, 1877, guarantees to our people an orderly form of government. Now, this reorganization come along, here's what they tell us. By the end of this school year, your ALOs are done. I remember there were No Child Left Behind Act. They had ELOs and there was plenty of technical assistance. Where's all the schools on the Pine Ridge that made it through No Child Left Behind back without getting tagged? Show me, raise your hand, which one are you? And so how good this technical assistance work for you people? Because our experience at Chine River, it don't work for us. So you're gonna have this new office over here in Kyland, that's nice. But I remember one thing about our area, one year, two people. In that time, from the late fall until the spring, people want to travel far, like maybe they want to get technical assistance over there in Turtle Mountain. I don't think they're going to do it so much. I don't even think they're going to make it to Cherry Creek, to Kakini. I don't think they're going to make it out to Four Bands at Swiftburg. I don't think they're going to make it a lot of places because the road's no good and the weather's no good and the winter's getting bad. Remember, folks? And so this technical assistance, here's how cool. The ELO line office is going to be gone. There's no promise, no money in the future to run the school. Where's the money going to come from? They're going to do away with the BIE. Then it's just a program, just like the chairman and the president say, just a program. What good the program going to do? Every one of these schools need an ELO to come out there and line them out on their finances. Raise your hand if I'm lying. I represent Marty Indian School. I represent other Indian schools. Here's what I know. The ELOs were the savior of the Indian schools because they kept them on the budget. Who's going to do that? They haven't identified that person, but I guarantee this. If they get out the budget, they're going to cut them off. What are you going to do? Where's all this money going to come from to run this tribal education department? I just want to know, where's that money coming from? Because I didn't see no money offered. I just see, self-determination. We're going to give all you Indians all the self-determination you want. Here you go. But you know, let's see why all of our red cup, yeah. Hakoza, we talked to you. You remember a grandchild. Well, my grandchild, the 10th of October, she just turned 6 months old. And you know, Papuja, I want her to have education. I think the United States is supposed to give it to her. Her grandma, Fogla, Oglala. I'm her Oglala Gapa, but I'm enrolled at Shan River, so that's kind of dope stuff. But I'm a Gapa nonetheless. And so I come here to talk to you about this here treaty, because if these people say they're going to shut it off, give you all the self-determination, I only got one question. How are you going to finance it? Because you ain't got the money. The two schools we've seen down south that want to do all their own curriculum. By the way, under the existing 10297, y'all have the right to do your own tribal education curriculum. Anyway, you don't need no reorganization to do your tribal curriculum. Anybody telling you you have to is a liar. You got the right. Nahansi Lakota Heo Chapalo, Kixiapo. Tokatakya, we choi chaga ki la toka upiksa. Uspe u chakyafo. Uspe u chakyafo. You don't pay the yohiba. You gotta talk it to them. If you don't hear you talk it to them, if they don't hear you sing it to them, they're not gonna know it. And I'm telling you, this comes from our treaty. You wanna give this up, let it go? No big deal? Okay. Then where the money gonna come from? You're gonna run your schools. Uncle Oliver, Uncle Johnson, they all say these things. They're not here, they're not live. Who's gonna be the gadpa? Who's gonna talk about Kakuja? The president of the tribe already say what he's done. My uncle Rick Tudog say what he's done. My cousin Richard Mookamp say what he's done. He say, Uncle Rick, he said, when I was a young man, he said, all the things I learned from my grandma and grandpa, they covered me. They covered me till things change. And I'm still covered, but things change. And so in the future, the generation, the education got to change. That's what my Uncle Rick say. You hear it? How many of you people here are you? He's here. Raise your hand. I think you people sit there, don't even have a translation, don't know what he said. You've got to know what these people say. They're giving you valuable information. You had a beautiful prayer here. This young man, he said wonderful thing in his prayer. We're thankful. My younger brother Melvin said good thing in his song of encouragement. But here's the thing, relative. If the BIE is going to shut itself down, which is the ultimate of this reorganization, so what? They're going to take it in Navajo, leave us the office in Kyle. So what? So what? Well, the so what is, if you remember under No Child Left Behind, BIE went to U.S. Department of Education and they cut a deal. and they put the state in charge. And they're gonna give us technical assistance. Okay, so we come all through that. So we had that lousy experience and we know it didn't help us none. And we got a tribal education agency, God bless them all, they don't have the wherewithal to help us like the BIE wanted to. They say we're gonna give all the authority to the tribal education agency. They got no money. We'll give you money, $150,000 over 3 years, and then we'll cut you off. That's what it said. I could read 25 U.S.C. section 2020. Did you guys read it? Did you read the secretarial order? Somebody convinced this secretary that abdicating their responsibility for Indian education somehow is self-determination. Right, it's self-determination. We're the self-determination. Hey, over in Auschwitz. Hey guys, you're all self-determination. Go feed yourself, find yourself food and water. Don't leave the line, because leave the line, we're going to machine gun you to death. But hey, you're on your own. You can self-determine your destiny here in Auschwitz. How much different is that? How much different is it? This is supposed to be the most Indian-friendly administration we had in generations, and they're the ones cutting us off? What the heck is going on? There's a treaty here. Do you people remember the treaty? You remember they say this? They're going up. Stand on this treaty. It ain't just me. I'm not just a gadfly. I'm just one of the kids. I was sitting around and I listened to Tom Badcock. I listened to Frank Woolstroke. I listened to James Underbaggage. I listened to Charlie Redcloud. I listened to Chief Oliver Redcloud and to Johnson Holyrock. I listened to them and they ain't here. And brother-in-law Harvey ain't around. So I gotta tell you people again, we try to see up. You gotta remember the grandchildren. See, I'm gonna be gone. I ain't planning to leave no time soon, but I'm 56. November the 14th, I'm gonna be 57, God willing. I'd like to be around for another 30 years so I could raise some cane and keep these treaty rights alive for grandchildren. But I'm a gaka. I got relations here in Lonesome Valley. And I want to tell you folks, I'm mad as heck what's going on here to our kids. And they're taking away our line offices, and after that, the whole thing's going to follow. And if you don't believe me, watch it happen. It's happening in front of your eyes. And they come here today to justify what they're doing. There's no justification for it. You can't fix education, Indian education, by shutting down the Bureau of Indian Education. Remember you see Bob and Ed? You know, the Ed side used to really stand for something in the Bureau. We had all these old people that used to come out here. My aunt and uncle, they were principal and teacher at an American course. At Kyle, right here. At Cherry Creek. At Longman. At Little Eagle. And then they became bureaucrats. Now they all become bureaucrats. Nobody ever go to the reservation. So everybody forget about us people here. Look, Ash, we got the issue. If you don't dig your heels in now, it's gone. It's already gone. You understand the ELOs are gone at the end of this year. We're coming to the process late, but we got to dig in. And I'm sorry that the Navajos and other people are well pleased with reorganization. I'm sorry they are. I guess they're getting what they want. But us people, putting an office in Kyle won't begin to fix it. We got federal schools. I'm done. Home, we got KP. And now my book up. It's a little book up. Go ahead. Let's check it out.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
We have two important topics that we need to try and finish today. And before we get into these, we want to talk a little bit about the history and how we ended up where we're at today. And we've asked Cecilia to come share that piece of it for us. And they give us some thoughts regarding that, or how we got to where we are today.
Okay, that's a big one and you have to have been a watch again, how many people gave. Miami, Piki, Michigan, Donna, Ahani, Piki, Omni, Piki, Maku, Oakland, Richard, Richard, Oak, Yasha. Nale, Nina, Piki, Alawanki. Alawanki had a dark, he was this, okay, so Michigan, Nina, he looked at him. Oh, Yala, Jay, Wana, Yala, Jay, Jay, Wana, and the Oloanki, each Iloa happy, not a Oloanki, each Iloa. So, Kantaki, watching Yapini, watching Yakati, me, Ashna, that's how to go my dinner. Taku, who pick up and eat the Oloa and the Mugati of each hunger, you want to eat with me. Head you get the still happy. Now, can I not go Oloa air a honey, oil culture? You have to be okay. Plus, you have to be okay. You have to have to go back to your children. It's done. One back to the PIR, the world is done. It's done. We will have our own need. So, get me down to your feet. Let me down to the leg of it to be. Forgot that the dog is kept there. You have to be. All you can want to do, you have to be. Another part of our character is we chose to be another. Oaiwa and Oawaiapi. Again, you have Wakanda and I'm Lakota. The Dawaiya had Dagnishni, and now Wakanda in Lakota, which are dogish and chukogi, Oaiwa, and you and Dalvish down the Kogata, and I can't Wakanda in Lakota. The head to every kid, you have been. Lean one year to order Haywalk Lakapi. Again, the Dan Kogata, the Haywalk Jerky. That, Tonga was there. You have my only partner, Kogata, here. Wakanda, Pina, Lena, let a better Dini Upin, and a half to whom who be dead, Dini Upin dead, and a doctor let her a two open that you are sick dead. I'd like to reach you with the word handshake with this feeling from my heart. Apologize, my culture on the way, my gentleman. The Piazza Kiosh by a man, the mother. The Kashuki Waka Okola DJ Owaka. I'm a matriarch in my medicine for society. The symbol of my office is to always carry my knife, so don't mess with me, got it? And so we bring the symbolism back. And the symbolism of my knife is my responsibility as a matriarch in my society. But this morning, I'd like to welcome our relatives and our partners who want to make this community move forward, Department of Education, Department of Health and Human Services. They care about us, and that's why they're here. I want to move forward and leave the politics out of the discussion for now. Politics are a very important component, as many of you heard, and treaty obligations. However, what we have to do today is use the power of the politics to create and bring more resources into our communities so our children can heal. How many of you want that? Our children are hurting, they're crying. And the only way we're going to be able to provide healing for them is to bring additional resources into our community. But you also heard my uncle and my big brother, my little brother, Richard Moosecamp. He keeps saying I'm younger than him. But anyway, so my little brother talked. And many of you, and I want to see your hand. How many of you, Lakota, sitting in this room, on your journey to be a good, solid, balanced human being, reached out to the ancestors in the ceremony to bring you here today? Let me see your hand. How many of you grabbed, watched it? And so we believe and know that our cultural teachings and our ceremony can help us heal. We want to expand on that. I'd like to welcome Pine Ridge School, Oglala Lakota County School, Ishnawi Chah, come in today, can be open, Kashuki with God, the open gig Allah, and be the hunt the Kashuki. Our seven tribal schools, our public schools, and our parochial schools. As I look around this room, many of us went to school at one of those four institutions. Some of us went to the Catholic school. Some of us went to Red Cross school like I did for 10 years. And that's why I learned how to speak English really good, really. Some of us went to Linwood. Some of us went to Christopher. Some of us went to Pine Ridge. It doesn't matter where we went to school. There's only one thing we have in common, and that we are Lakota people. Is that not true? Yes. I also want to remind us that no matter what school board you sit on, be it the public, be it the parochial, or the tribal school, that all we have in common, which is the most important thing that we have in common, is our Lakota children. That's all what we have in common. And what we need to also do as adults and leaders in our education system is please transcend and move beyond your school. This is not about Catholic school. This is not about public school. This is not about state-funded school. This is not about federal schools. We get our resources in many different ways. However, the common denominator of why we're here today is how do we put all of our minds, our energies, our spirit, our prayers together to create for the future, healthier Lakota children. Is that not why we're here? And so I want to challenge each and every one of you to move beyond your role, whether you're a superintendent or administrator, a school board member, or a tribal leader, move beyond your role and look to how we can use your skills, your energy, your education, your passion as we create a future for our children on the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation. How many of you want that? And in Washington Way, they say, collective, collective. Ahani. We didn't think about ourselves. Leadership a long time ago was not about what I could get for me, but what could be a benefit all of the people. The term is the collective. And what we do and how we do it, that will benefit all of the people within the boundaries of the Pine Ridge Reservation. And these are the children in the future. I also want to say how proud I am of our culture. Within other cultures, there are different definitions, but the Lakota culture is that men and women share responsibility for the well-being of our nation. Is that not true? We are a complementary society. We are complementary, which means that we work side by side together for the well-being of the people, be it the tribe, be it the community, be it your school. O-U-E-C-L-P. We're here to help each other, but most importantly, to think collectively for the well-being of the future. Let me give you an example. Last week, I prayed at the Buffalo Pastor. I made a little altar out there. And I go sit with the mama buffalo and the baby buffalo to remind me of my role as a Lakota woman, that I'm responsible to do what I can with the help of the buffalo. You know, when you probably saw that picture when they almost annihilated all of our buffalo, huh? And so when I go to the buffalo pasture, I see the buffalo running around. And that's a very important lesson to me. They almost killed off our buffalo, but are they still alive, my relative? Yes, they are. Our buffaloes are living, thriving, and they still contribute to us, do they not? In our ceremonies and our food, when we drink the blood of that first buffalo kill, that provides us with even more strength to do what we have to do. So using the example of the buffalo who is nearly annihilated, but is now living among us, and our close spiritual relationship with the buffalo, I also want to remind us, let's use the Buffalo as our guide for the future. They live and thrive, and they still live among us, and those are our close relatives. So let's use the example of the Buffalo. How many of you know that I do a lot of healing work with people? So three things I want to ask everybody today. From this day forward, we will no longer say historical trauma. How many of you are sick of that word? Come on. No more historical trauma. Because when you say historical trauma, what are we doing? We're blaming, right? We blame. Yes. Yes. Bad things happen to us as a nation, as a people. Yes, yes. We experience many, many things that were not good. However, we spent time and energy talking about it, defining it. Well, doggone it, I'm sick and tired of it. I want to move ahead. How about you? Come on. Give me a round of applause. How many of you want to move ahead? Let's stop blaming the past. And let's use the strengths of who we are. And the strengths of who we are is indicative of all the people in this room who are Lakota, who have come from there to here. So let's celebrate and pull into the future. No more historical trauma discussion. None of that anymore. Hedge it. When I have no gaki papi, ask then ha uhimuniki. And so the other word I want to remove from my language and your language is the word suicide. That's the Washiji word, is it not? Suicide. I was talking about it in Lakota. The first translation for suicide, each day, they kill themselves. The next translation is that in Lakota, Wichoni is what? Life. When somebody dies, we say, Wichoni eki inake. They set aside the rest of life. Hedge it, you check. So, in thinking about it, I come to the conclusion that when a person chooses to leave, hear me out, when a person chooses to leave, they get, we told me he teaches you. Does that make sense, Malcolm? We told me he teaches you. For whatever reason, that they no longer had the desire to live, for whatever reason, many years of trauma and pain, no support. We know the story that one day they said, hey, ha, ni wa uwa chishi. So we choni ki ni kichu. Does that make sense? So that falls down to a very important English word called choice. So that person who decided that day they no longer wanted to live made that decision and that choice to leave us. And we must honor and respect that choice and decision because that is their choice, is it not? So I want to take the word suicide out of any discussion because Henry Choney, he eats you. They took back their life. And that's okay. So within the concept of Western thinking, within the concept of Christianity, they always say, when you do this, it's a sin. And many of our people are so colonized, they believe that. But it's not. It's not. I like to believe that when somebody decides to leave us, and they chose to leave, that they will go back and cross to Chambuwaksan, and they will go back and be with their relative. Because it doesn't matter how you die, your relative will always be there to embrace you. How many of you believe that? Yes. So today, the research is very clear. The adverse childhood experiences study defines 10 traumatic events in a child's life that set the foundation for how they live and see the world. Not only does it create that definition, but I'm not even going to statistics. We don't have to cite statistics here today because each and every one of us on a day-to-day basis, be it in the classroom, out in the community, we are seeing the effects of early childhood trauma. How many of you know that? The effect of early childhood trauma is reflected in the children's ability to learn. When you're full of fear and anxiety, when you're full of uncertainty, when you don't know how things are going to be at the house, that does impact the child's ability to learn. How do you know that? We know that. So from this day forward, I want us to not, all we can do today is talk about what we can do as educational institutions collectively to provide more therapeutic services for our children within the halls and in our institutions. We want to be able to provide healing opportunities for all of our children, to be able to talk about the traumas in their lives, play therapy, art therapy, and most importantly, to be able to validate the healing method that many of us have experienced within our ceremonies at Ochoa. And so our people can heal. So part of the reason why I am honored to say these few words, it's because we are here today to work together collectively, whether you're at Red Cloud or Pine Ridge or at Shannon County, I'm sorry, Oglala, Lakota County, I still say Shannon County, and then all of our tribal schools and our VIA schools. We're here because we have one responsibility and one responsibility only, and that is for the well-being of our children. We as institutions, whether it's Red Cloud or New Moon or American Horse School, we have people who care about the culture and language. We have people who are knowledgeable about how to put a plan together. We are charged by the Tribal Council to have standards in Lakota language and culture. We are charged by the Oglala Tribal Council to have a curriculum in place. And I want us to share any all information to have a standard in the curriculum that's going to be achievable across the whole reservation. How many of you want that? And when we sit down and we work on our standards and our curriculum, please, please do not take the my way or the highway attitude. Do not say we're doing it better or we're doing it this way and that way. Because your knowledge and what you've done is important for me. Philomena, my sister, has been doing it forever. I look around and through Will, they've been doing culture stuff. So we are all Lakota. We all speak Lakota. Our ceremonies are the same, our songs are the same. So we as human beings are left with the greatest challenge of all, is set aside our own, our biases and what we think is going to work best, and collectively have an opportunity to talk about it and come out of here in the next year with a wonderful plan to incorporate culture and language across the whole reservation. How many of you want that? How many of you want that? And I want to also provide my appreciation and respect for all of you in this room who have taken on the task of creating curriculum, teaching methodology on how we're going to teach our culture and language. Just because you speak Lakota does not mean you can teach it. How many of you know that? Just because you speak Lakota does not mean you have the knowledge, skills, and expertise to teach it. But the most important thing that I personally want for all Lakota children on this reservation, do well thinking for your watching niche. Lakota chestyalayungapi. Me do it. Me do it. Who are you? We do it. Who are you? And when we ask the question, we do it. Who are you? You should be able to cite four generations of who you come from. Is that true? You should be able to cite all of the people like here in Pine Ridge. Let me tell you, we have Chief Linwood. We have Chief Bullbear. Chief Young American Horse, Chief Young Man of Fraser's Horses. All of these are our grandfathers, and we come from grandfathers who fought at the Little Bighorn. These people fought to preserve a way of life. Final thing, in 1905, at the inauguration of Teddy Roosevelt, was the first time a president rode horseback down Constitution Avenue. And behind him were six chiefs. American Horse was there. Geronimo was there. Cochise was there. Quetta Parker. These are the names of many nations who fought to the very last minute to preserve a way of life. The symbolism of those chiefs and their regalia, riding horseback behind Teddy Roosevelt, said one thing to me. And that one thing that I saw my relatives is this. They said, we will live under the flag of the United States. There's just too damn many of those immigrants, and they just have too many guns. And there's no damn way we're going to do them. Darn it. And so I look at that image, and I have it hanging in my home office to remind me that the powerful chief made a decision to live within what the United States flag represents. How many of you believe that? Come on. And that's about treaties as well. So today, I want to ask everybody here, please set aside your biases. Please set aside what you see is the best way to do it, because I want you to put that aside. And how do we move forward to create an agenda for the future? Because these little ones, and not the webbies from Kiapanga, the webbies from Kiapanga, Diamond. And so the other final thing is this. We do need to do healing work in our communities and our schools. Come on, schools. How many need that? We spend so much time trying to teach them that we forget that along with teaching them, we need resources to provide therapeutic services in our school, be it the immigrant way, be it counseling and whatever, but also to validate our healing practices as Lakota people. So please, my relative, let us work together today for the future, because in that circle of mind, heart, body, and spirit, we spent a lot of time looking at the damage that was done to us, individually or collectively. Let's use that same model and make a line straight across it. And how do we strengthen the mind, heart, body, and spirit, not only of our children, but the children's family will benefit from it. I look forward to whatever we do. And the final thing, President Steele, I hope the word is that, that in order to be able to accomplish a collective effort, so we passed this report out. Some of you got it. This was a lot of work done back in March. We spent one whole day with students from all of our schools, Red Cloud, Little Moon, Pine Ridge, Crazy Horse. And these students put a lot of input into this. And they tell us what's wrong. And these are the things that they think that they told us what they wanted. However, in order to achieve anything that's recommended in here, and anything that we talk about today, I'm going to ask the Oglala tribe to set aside and get resources to hire full-time staff to make this thing keep moving. How many of you want that? In order to make it happen, we need some warm bodies who are totally committed to this endeavor. We need warm bodies who are going to take every objective and every time frame in that objective to move it forward, to bring it to completion. That's what we need. How many know that? So, and then we need somebody we can trust. Somebody who's going to work with all the schools, with all the institutions. Somebody who's going to be able to take those objectives, put time limits, time frames on it, and move it forward. And please, please, my relatives, let's keep damn politics out of it. How many of you want that? Come on. And our politics get in the way sometimes. He said, she said, they said, blah, blah, blah. Dang it, if we could put all that energy into stopping something, let's translate that energy we use into stopping things and move it forward. Come on, that, huh? How many of you want that? Come on, let's do it. So today, my relatives, in the spirit of the buffalo, who was almost annihilated and still living in Washington, okay? In the spirit of our relatives that is so close to us, they proved to us that they could live. So let's prove to them, by their example, that we want to live. Let's prove to them And find the final thing. You know, how many of you know there's some people that will never get it in our community? Come on. How many of you know we have a couple of generations that will never get well? Huh? So let's just say, let them do what they need to, and let's put all our energy. Let's not fix adults. Okay? If you adults have choices, if you want to continue to be miserable, be miserable. But let's take the time, opportunity to sit down and create a plan for healing for our children with a vision down the road that we will grow with Lakota who will be balanced in mind, heart, body, and spirit. And that's what I want, and that's why I'm here today. Please don't keep on my ass. Keep my ass. Stop the way two people say you won't kick your head or cat you think. I ask some of you to ask your spirit helpers to come help you think clearly. I want you to take away all your biases and misgivings, and nobody can say. The other thing I want people to do today is don't say, we tried that before and it didn't work. Don't go there. Let's move ahead. Let's move ahead and see what we can create, because my relatives, every one of us here from all the schools, and I'm really happy that we're all here together. How about you? I see Pinery School, I see Red Cloud, I see Wounded Knee, and we're all responsible for the future. So let's take advantage of that, and let's use this time and opportunity with resources that are going to be coming to us to make something work for the future. That's what I want, and I want you to want that too. And so as the day goes by and you move into the topic matter, please, please, think positive, think forward, and leave politics out of it, because this is for the welfare of our children. So, hey, kill out my help, give me that guy.
So with that, I want to, the other part is that I heard the president from Cecilia, from some of those that I visited with, some side conversation, and I'll start listening to you, being sneaky, is that important to coming together. Who's doing what? Maybe there's one community that's a little bit ahead of the other one. How can we take that, what's happening there that's good, and bring that back and allow that to affect our own school systems, our own school, or to come together as a whole and say, these are the good things that are happening. These are the pieces that are having success. Let's take these from the top. Let's take these best practices and let's share them with everybody so then we know what's doing well. So with that, I just wanted to share those few thoughts as we go along here, and I want to, we're coming up on a break here pretty quick, but before we do, I want to invite Bill Mendoza up to share a few words, and also I believe Stacy Epapi will be also talking, and I'll let Bill introduce her when he's done. Round of applause, please.
Bill Mendoza, Executive Director of White House Initiative on American Indian and Alaska Native Education, Tepemachia. Lakota Kile wants a Nichiche, Dueni Yodiawaye, Wachishiwa. Gakawayeki, Gakana Namuchiwayeki, Gala Twist, George Gala Twist. Jesse Mendoza Sr. Donna Twist. Omar. Rich Law, thank you for allowing me to say a few words. I guess as things stack up, I might be the head today. For that, I apologize to my elders, especially. I hail from this tribe. Much of the communities here, I have family here in this community and all across the reservation. And I'm Oglala and Sichongu. And so I have deep roots in Rosebud. And so I just apologize to all my teachers here, all my elders for trying to share a few things on behalf of a lot of our colleagues who are here today from the federal government. And I saw a meeting with her for Mila this morning, and I said, You have to pull that thing out and let me know so I can fall down. And if we had a misstep, if not a miscommunication, I thought Lakshi was going to pull out, Lakshi and Emery was going to pull out his bayonet on me there earlier. But I thank him for his encouragement and making sure that we hold true to the protocols to start these things out in the appropriate way. And so if we make any missteps in that, just know that we're trying. We have, for all intents and purposes, a real opportune time here. As Lakshi McDonald stated earlier, you have folks like myself, you have folks like Stacy, you have folks like this man here, Director Russell, Chia Director Russell, and you have a lot of others that have been engaged with this community since December and in a more focused way. Very challenging to not only overcome some of those shortcomings, if not harm that we have created on these communities for many years, and needs to stop. And I really appreciated all of the speakers that they had to share our effort to, well, I was geeking out back there, oftentimes across the country. I faced the responsibility not only advocating for my own community, but being able to speak for all of our children. And that number is about 2 million, if we take its most liberal terms. And the numbers become more focused to about 1.5 million. And trying to change those circumstances for all those students. So when you guys are talking, man, he's on fire. Like, oh. Jeremy, you got up, you needed to say those things, and I'm glad he's saying them. Especially for the youth who are in the room with us today. I think this report is so important, and it's the exception rather than the norm of how our nations are conducting business, and especially that nation. With the president's visit to Standing Rock, that influence from folks like in our area of the country, okay, Jody especially, that no longer are we going to have conversations about our children without them. And so just encouragement to those young people who are in the room with us that you're not only the current concern that we're talking about by way of improving those outcomes that you deal with, those indicators, the real things that you deal with day in and day out, but we're here to expand those opportunities. And your perspective, your voice is essential to that. And so just encouraging you for your patience, encouraging you to share, and our adults, all our caregivers, our service providers, our leaders, to challenge yourself to communicate with them in ways that they're needing to be engaged. We had to learn this the hard way. We just released an important report that is localizing these conversations. Not dismissing anybody of their responsibilities, all those systemic things that were talked about, all of the responsibilities. But ultimately, those youth's voice are tremendously powerful. And we know that. But even in our engagement with them, we had to change things around a little bit. We started out, we lined up the typical Fed style, we had planning committees, we really worked hard to try to have the conversation be meaningful. And even when we got to the table with youth, it was too sterile of an environment. All those well-intentioned efforts, it was just still not enough. And so we took down the panel, we brought people in places like this, we had deeper conversations ahead of time. We learned that we had to help equip them with the language to express what they were feeling. And you know, we even had to have elders come and encourage them to share, not only share with us, but trust us, folks that they haven't been able to historically trust before, whether we look like them or not, but to trust the community members to trust the elders with what they have to share about their own communities. And so the conversations progressed in that way. But we did 9 cities and 7 states, and every story, every testimony, if you will, was important. And none was elevated above other, any other. You know, there was that whole spectrum of trauma that we talked about. And as we bring together these conversations, we're holding our colleagues accountable for doing things in a different way than they have historically. Even among, as President Steele said, we have a lot of other things that are as much of a priority as these systems that we're interacting with. And when he shared with us at the White House what his concerns was, he talked about those 4 systems. He talked about them doing really good work within those systems, but that not enough work was being done in relationship to one another. And so there was born the idea of how do we bring these conversations together in a large land-based tribe like this, to not only inform and not relinquish ourselves of that trust responsibility, those treaty responsibilities, but to be a better actor within that. And it's going to take, in many ways, stepping up if it's resources, or stepping back if it's the need of free-flowing information to break down some of those barriers, to address those indicators, to improve those outcomes, and to expand those opportunities. And so it's in that spirit that we kept the Fed footprint small today. We said that there's going to need to be relationship building among these systems. Everything that Cecilia said was spot on. And in our responsibility, it's again to listen, but to engage. Not consultation at its worst, consultation at its best, where we don't necessarily start with a clean slate. We start with something meaningful. And we say, how can this inform our work? What more needs to be added to this snapshot of our recent strengths? What more can we do? How can we redirect, if need be, with some of the things that we've proceeded with certain assumptions? And so the folks who are here have been selected pretty strategically because they have, for all intents and purposes, the lion's share of accountability and opportunity in this area. And if I could for a minute, then they might not all be in the room, but just have our federal employees, not the Bureau of Operated Schools, leadership level or staff, but our representative, our leadership from agencies, if you could just stand up for a second so people can know who you are. And so we have not only representatives from DOI and HHS and the Department of Education, and our USDA and other offices at different levels. But there's also a fleet of others that wanted to be here with you today. So I don't want to misrepresent in any way that there weren't people who were committed to being here, but we're in all the appropriate ways wanting 4 of these this year to develop this community, to be a part of this community. And I don't know about you guys, but I'm still a pup here, but I don't remember the last time we were all in one room having such a conversation. And the responsibility will be on all of us to carry that water back, to carry that fire back, to lead and make sure people are connected to this effort. And so I just want to offer those words of encouragement, express the gratitude of my boss. I think I can say this and not get in too much trouble, the great black father. Even in this day, we're challenging those notions of change. You pay attention to the news, maybe you might either go back to the great white father or the great white mother, who knows? So change is on the horizon before we know that it comes all too often, but I just want to share those words and thank you for allowing me.
That's the first time I've heard that on a real song. I was just looking at this report that was handed out, and I just wanted to hit on a couple of things real quick. It's on executive summary, it's on page 7. But it's a middle and high school vision consensus statement. So this came from your youth. Encouragement and support for lifelong goals. Counselors and people to talk to everywhere youth are, in homes, at school, and community. Adults, pass down respect and tradition to build character as strong people with strong culture. Help and assistance, caring for everyone. Places where we can feel accepted and get help. Encouragement of feelings and hope. Then it has college age vision consensus statements. An involved, healthy, future-focused community that's self-aware of how we affect each other and we collaborate together toward a common goal. Leaders that value diversity, equality, and strive to be the type of people they themselves would want to follow. Traditions, programs, and a culture of teaching that influences values and knowledge in our youth. Isn't that great? That's coming from your youth. That's coming from your middle and high school students and your college students. And I know they might not hear us today, but let's give them a round of applause for this growth report. I'm just really happy to see that, and I hope you are too, from the community, is that everything that, you know, what we've been sharing prior to sharing this is that it shows within your youth, with your students, that they're grasping the importance of culture and the value system that we have as Lakota people, and how that's important for us in regard to moving forward. I see that in those statements that the students have provided. So thank you very much, sir. With that, I think we're ready for a break. And thanks, right? But let's come back in about 10 minutes, and on your folders, there's a number. And we want you to come back to whatever number is on your folder. Come back to that table. After break, come back to, if your table 4 is on your folder, come back and sit at table 4. We want you to mix it up a little bit, and then we're gonna turn it over to some presentations and some process work.